Today, we're going to be talking about a requested topic. So specifically requested, I think it was in the last live stream, was the topic of burnout, clean up procedures. We have a couple of apprentices from Lake Technical on the line. So we've got Chad and we've got Jessica. So say hi, Chad and Jessica.
Hello.
Hello.
And then we also have Jandy here, otherwise known as John/Andy. Coming online now. So anyway, and then we have the great Eric Mele, expert in all things HVAC and especially R. How's it going, Eric?
It's going good.
Yeah, glad to hear it. So Joe said that he specifically wanted to talk about HH dryers, but he probably forgot that we were doing this. So maybe Eric will text him. But anyway, we're going to start at the basics. We're talking about burnout. And so I'm going to go ahead and pull up this bulletin from Emerson so that way you can all see it here. So give me 1 second while I pull this up, because this is sort of this bulletin is generally considered to be the Bible in terms of clean out procedures. I'm going to zoom in a little bit so hopefully you can see it a little bit better. I'm obviously not going to read it because that would be extremely boring, but to start with, this is an older version. I don't know if there's a newer revision of this. Maybe somebody can look that up while I'm going through it. This is the one I could find easily. I don't think there's any significant differences other than that, because this is from 2008, it refers to like CFCs and, you know, like they Emerson strongly supports refrigerant recovery. That's sort of a no duh at this point. But when we're talking about the industry accepted procedure for burnout, we first have to start with what is burnout? What does it even mean? So I'm gonna turn that. Well, actually, Eric, I want you to give me a definition, Eric. What makes something a burnout?
When it has an electrical failure inside the compressor where it arcs to ground.
Well, what if it arcs winding to winding?
Or to winding to winding, but there's basically an electrical fire inside the compressor.
Yes. Yeah. Already a few glasses of whiskey in, Eric already can't pronounce words.
No, I haven't. I don't even have a good excuse for not being able to talk right now.
You're slurring.
Yeah.
Well, you have a baby, so you don't get as much sleep as you should. So we'll use that as the excuse.
There we go.
He worked too hard today. That's what happened.
It was a big day, so I heard. All right. So yes, you have some sort of a short circuit, whether it's to ground or winding to winding. You had an arc inside the compressor. That arc burns the oil and refrigerant and whatever's in proximity to it, and it creates acids and waxes and all other kinds of nastiness that then gets potentially cycled through the system when you go through and make the repair. I don't think there's any other real case where you're going to have a burnout other than in a shorted or grounded application. So when we say shorted or grounded, we're really referring to obviously a compressor, because that's the only electrical component inside the system that has the potential to create a burnout condition. So that's what we're talking about first. Now, the next thing is every electrical short, is every grounded situation or short winding to winding, is every one a burnout? And I think that's a little bit of a, I don't want to say a controversy, but because I think to some extent, everyone is, but I would be interested in your take on that, Eric. Is everything a burnout that involves a shorted compressor or a grounded compressor?
I haven't cut open enough to say for sure. I mean, you could have an electrical fault that happens so fast that it doesn't contaminate the system, but when you have a burnout, you sure know it because, you know, just the smell of the refrigerant when you gauge up.
Right. And that's something to pay attention to. And that's even suggested in a lot of these, in a lot of these specifications, is paying attention to how it smells. Let's see if we can find their definition here in this guide. I just have this up just so some of you, if you feel like looking at it or if you feel like pulling it up, it is AE24-1105. That is the Emerson, IE Copeland, bulletin that covers this topic. And it talks kind of just briefly about how it's important to recover and evacuation and all that. but it, let's see if we can find it here. So it's essential that all foreign materials be removed from the system at the time of the original installation. Many of these contaminants are so small, they'll pass through, blah, blah, blah. And I think what they're saying there is like, if you have these type of contaminants, because this is general, this isn't just burnouts. This is the cleaning of refrigeration systems. So it's not just talking about burnouts. It's talking about any sort of contaminants. If you have solid contaminants in the system, what do you do about it? Now, one thing that I want to, one term that people use that I want to go ahead and myth bust very quickly is people will say non-condensables. They'll call all of these contaminants non-condensables, and that's not what a non-condensable is. A non-condensable is a gas that does not condense. So air, nitrogen are really the two true non-condensables that we get inside of a system. These are not non-condensables. These are solid contaminants, acids, and other general nasties that get in the system. So before we even get to the what to do after you know you have a burnout, we have to address why it happens in the first place. And the main reason that it happens in the first place is poor procedures in the initial setup, and specifically moisture left in the system due to an improper evacuation. That would be one of the most common causes, or any other sort of solid contamination that's able to get into the compressor. Now, you also can have any mechanical failure. So if you have a compressor that's losing lubrication because it's overheating, or a compressor that's slugging, those mechanical failures can also cause those electrical failures. But among them is, of course, evacuation, which is why they talk about it really quickly here. Now, again, it also references triple evacuation here. I actually just recently did a podcast on this topic because it is sort of, it is kind of one of those old school things that people did more of when they didn't have vacuum rigs that could really effectively pull deep vacuums. That's not really the purpose of this conversation, but we do know that pulling good vacuums is really critical. But let's get here where it talks about system cleaning procedure after a hermetic motor burnout, because that is specifically what we're talking about here. And let's go ahead. I said I wasn't going to read, but let's go ahead and read this one, because this is specifically about what we're saying here. When a motor burnout occurs in the compressor, the resulting high temperature arc causes a portion of the refrigerant oil mixture to break down into a carbonaceous sludge. That means a carbon sludge, corrosive acid, and water. It's been long recognized that such contamination resulting from a burnout can result in repeated failures if the contaminants are allowed to reach and remain in the crankcase of the replacement compressor. The situation can be prevented by following proper cleanup procedures after a burnout. So let's stop there. What we're saying here is that if you have a burned out compressor and you take and just slam another compressor in there without taking specific measures in order to prevent problems with the next one, those acids are going to make it into the sludge, and the corrosive acids and water are going to make it into the new compressor and damage it as well. And so that's what we want to prevent through this process. So then it goes into the next thing here. Flushing out or the refrigeration system with R11. Now, this is not talking about RX11 flush. It is talking about the actual refrigerant R11, which is the refrigerant that was most often used for cleaning up systems back in the day. And the reason for that is because it had a very high boiling temperature. When I was in school, my instructor actually took some R11 and dumped it in our hands, and we could watch it boiling in our hands. Now, he shouldn't have done that, but it is what he did. Because R11 boiled, I think, something like 50 degrees, something like that, at atmospheric pressure. So it had a very high boiling temperature, and it was used to flush systems. You put liquid R11 through the lines, and that would flush it. So here, it basically says, don't do that because of the emissions. It doesn't give any other reasons here. So this doesn't specifically address aftermarket flushes. We're going to talk a little bit about that as we go forward. In fact, I need to make a note of that to make sure that I remember to mention that aftermarket flushes. So anyway, Emerson recommends, and this is still their recommendation, recommends the filter dryer cleaning procedure. So this is what the company that makes Copeland, which is, you know, the largest, most respected compressor manufacturer. When I say largest, I don't know if that's by numbers, but I think we all recognize Copeland as being the authority on compressors. They recommend using the filter dryer cleaning method. This involves the use of approved filter dryers, incorporating an adequate desiccant, that a desiccant is a drying agent, not a filter only, in both the liquid and suction lines. This system cleaning procedure has been used in countless installations, so on and so forth. So we're going to go through the actual specific procedure here now, but before we do that, I want to talk quickly just about what this means in practice. And that means that whenever, and we know this already, whenever you open the system, you're supposed to be putting a liquid line filter dryer in it. If it's a heat pump, then it needs to be a bi-flow dryer. If it's straight cool, it can be a single direction or a bi-flow dryer. We put those in the liquid line every time the system is open for service. But now we're adding in the suction dryer. And the suction dryer is really the big difference here. And dealing with suction dryers is actually pretty critical. So this is basically just, you know, really standard stuff. How do you, you know, how you get the system ready to do this, you know, inspecting everything, making sure that if possible, we can figure out the cause before we even get any further in it. Remove and install, remove all installed filter dryers and clean or replace any filters or strainers. So if you're working in a refrigeration application where you have serviceable strainers on valves, you need to replace those. And then you have to remove all installed filter dryers. That means all suction dryers. That means any of the sort of spun copper dryers that come in a lot of these factory units, anything like that, we've got to replace those. Got to pull them out and replace them. Now, key thing here is that we want to think about whether or not putting that dryer back in the same place is our best bet, or if we would want to straight pipe that previous location and put it in a new location. So that's a decision that you're going to have to make. And in a lot of cases, straight piping the previous location where it was before and putting it in a new location is your best bet, especially if you're working in a residential application and you've got a liquid line dryer that's inside the condensing unit, which makes it very difficult to service. In many cases, that's going to make a lot more sense, especially if, when you run the possibility that you're going to have to replace it again in the future. So you do that. So you're just replacing them. Install an Emerson HMI or AMI moisture indicator to precisely monitor system moisture conditions if the system does not have one. So they're suggesting putting in a moisture indicator, basically a moisture indication sight glass, to see if you have dealt with moisture. Now, I would suggest that if you are pulling a good vacuum and you're looking at sort of the modern micron gauges and following our procedures there, in residential, you're probably not going to do this step, but it isn't a terrible idea, actually, to follow this step. I just want to pause here real quick because we're getting a couple questions about quick check moisture indicators and that sort of thing, acid scavenger, that kind of stuff. We're going to get to that later. But when we talk about going up to a system that has a known short or known ground, at that point, you can be sure that there are some acids and carbon inside. The question is to what extent. So how much of it is there? Doing sort of the quick tests where you take and you just put it on the port and it just measures a little bit of refrigerant. Those have been proven to be pretty inaccurate. I mean, they're going to give you a lot of false negatives. So there's, you know, a lot of cases it's going to tell you there's nothing wrong when there actually is acid. But are they better than the sniff test? Yeah, probably better than the sniff test. And if you use them in combination with the sniff test, it's better than nothing. In fact, we use them quite often. There are much more thorough tests that actually test system oil. For example, if you're going to be doing a burnout test on something like a large commercial unit or a grocery store, especially, you know, parallel rack systems where you've got multiple compressors at stake, you're going to want to actually use a real oil sample and a more thorough acid test, which isn't that hard to do in those applications because you can actually get to the oil system. So getting a little oil out isn't that hard. If you're doing it on a residential system, it can be a little bit more tricky because, you know, it takes a little bit longer to get that oil out. Anyway, so our next step is to install the recommended size. And of course, they say Emerson, but you know, any trusted brand, among them, Emerson, Sporlan, and Danfoss are the three most, you know, widely recognized brands in this area that make these liquid line and suction line filter dryers. So they want you to install a recommended size. And so you have to look at the capacity and the type of refrigerant that you're working on to figure out what the recommended size is for the given application before you proceed. You can't just take what's on your truck. Just because the ports on the line dryer fit the line that you're connecting them to does not mean that what you're putting in is the right size. It takes a little bit more investigation, actually looking at the tables and guides in order to figure out what is the right size dryer from the manufacturer that you're installing. So you know, one takeaway here is don't just go in a burnout, especially, but anytime you're putting a line dryer in, whether it's liquid or suction, and just slam in what you have in your truck without considering, is this the right size? Now it's basically just saying, make sure that you recover and evacuate according to standard practices, which that's a standard thing. Once we start the compressor and put the system in operation, and this is a really key part right here. These next couple parts here are where a lot of the debate in the industry comes up. It says, start the compressor, put the system in operation. As the contaminants in the system are filtered out, the pressure drop across the filter dryer will increase. Specifically, we're talking more about the suction dryer here, but really it's both. The nice thing with a suction dryer is we have the ports generally on both sides that allow us to measure that pressure drop. So when it says observe the pressure differential across the filter dryers, that's much easier to do on a suction dryer. On a liquid line dryer, the only thing you can do is look for temperature differential. And really any significantly measurable temperature differential used with an accurate clamp thermometer, the same one on both sides, anything that you're seeing over a degree is going to tell you have pressure drop and you should probably go ahead and replace it. But on the suction line dryer, we're going to go down to the table below and show you acceptable pressure drops here in a second. It says observe the pressure differential across the filter dryers for a minimum of 4 hours. So they're actually suggesting that you, after you start this thing, you actually sit there and baby it for 4 hours. It is a good practice, not a bad idea, not something that pretty much anybody's going to do in residential. You may start it up and come back the next day or something like that, but almost nobody's going to do this part. Is it a best practice though? Yes, it is. And so we have to be clear sometimes about just because something's a best practice, it may not be financially feasible, may not be something that the customer is going to want to pay for given the value here. But for example, if you were putting a compressor in to a really critical application like a grocery store refrigeration system, or a very large commercial system that was mission critical, this would be a best practice. Operate it for 4 hours and monitor that pressure drop to make sure that it's not becoming contaminated. You couldn't afford to take out that new compressor. If the pressure drop exceeds the maximum limit shown in table one for the temporary installation, replace the filter dryer and restart the system. So we're going to go down to table one here in a second. Now it says after the completion of step seven, allow the unit to operate for 48 hours. So now it's saying give it two days, check the odor, warning smell of the refrigerant, and compare the color of the oil with the sample taken in step two. Use of an Emerson Universal Acid Alert Test Kit. So this is a type of acid test kit is recommended to test for acid content. Again, more practical on bigger systems where you have a separate oil system and you can actually get to the oil. It can be done in smaller systems, but probably practically you're going to use those smaller test kits or other types of test kits. Refrigeration Technologies makes a really nice test kit. I invited John Pastorello last second to come on, but we have a podcast that I did with him several years back where we talk about this. And, again, the more thorough you are, the more likely you're going to catch additional problems before they become an issue. If you are less thorough, it's more likely you're going to take out the new compressor. And so long as you're willing to eat it because of lack of processes, okay. But I think our goal should be to prevent that new compressor from having an issue. If the oil is discolored, has an acid odor or is acidic, or if the moisture indicator indicates high moisture content in the system, then change the filter dryers again. The compressor oil can be changed if considered desirable. Now this would be a really big one, doing a full oil change afterwards. That would be, a Mac Daddy procedure again. If you don't have a serviceable oil system, that means you're going to have to cut that compressor out, take it out, dump it out. I mean, that's a real, real process. Probably not something, again, in residential that most of us are going to do. So segment of the industry makes a huge, huge difference. Allow the system to operate another 48 hours and recheck as before, repeat, test, smell, all that sort of thing. Once you have done this, all of this, then they want you to replace the liquid line filter dryer with an EK. So two most common types of liquid line filter dryers are the HH, which is a high wax filter dryer, and the EK, which is sort of your basic standard liquid line filter dryer, which is less restrictive. So they do want you, if you're using an HH or an acid type of liquid line filter dryer, they do want you going back later, taking those out and putting back in an EK. If you're working on a system where you've got replaceable cores, obviously that's much easier. You just valve them off, swap them out, again, big commercial, grocery, those sorts of things where you have serviceable cores, that's going to be a standard procedure and really should be part of the process. So any of you who are listening and who are in that world, really, if you're in the big, you know, big cases where you're, you know, replacing giant scrolls or semi-herms or screws or anything like that, these processes really should be followed, you know, to the T to make sure that you're not going to have another problem. And residential, we often are going to, you know, kind of make exceptions, and every company is going to have slightly different procedures. And we'll talk about, you know, what some practical procedures are, or what, you know, good companies tend to do, what some of the trade-offs are. I know right now it sounds like I'm being super idealistic, but I'm just showing you what the best practices, and then we'll kind of talk about some different procedures. Now we have table one, and this is a really useful one. So for those of us who are working on R410A systems, which is going to be typical for air conditioning, we see that if we're going to leave a suction line dryer in permanently, if we're not going to pull it back out again, and obviously if they were saying that you absolutely could not leave them in permanently, then they wouldn't have this table. So people who say that you absolutely have to pull them out, well, why would it say permanent installation here then? You know, they're making an exception here and saying that if you are going to leave them in permanently and it's an air conditioning application, then you cannot have more than a 3 PSI pressure drop after it's had a chance to stabilize, after it's gone through all the cleanup procedures. So you can't measure it after 10 minutes of operating, see you have a 3 PSI pressure drop and say all is well. That is the maximum that you can allow. If you're going to commercial or low temperature, then it's even less. And then for temporary installations, they're saying, all right, you can let it go a little bit higher so long as you're pulling that sucker out again pretty quick. Key things here that I know a lot of technicians don't do is they don't go back and check the pressure drop. So at the minimum, this is something we need to be doing across all disciplines. If you have a burned out compressor and you put a suction line dryer in, at minimum, you need to go back and check the pressure drop across that suction line dryer. And if it is 3 PSI or more, then you need to pull it out. So that needs to be part of the procedure, because like we talked about in the last live stream that we did, when you have pressure drops on suction line dryers that are significant at all, as soon as they get above this 3 PSI number, it is going to greatly impact your compression ratio, because drops in suction pressure greatly impact compression ratio, which is going to decrease your efficiency, capacity, and compressor cooling. Like basically the you know, the three horsemen of issues down the road can occur if you leave a plugged filter dryer in the system. So make sure you don't do that. Now, since I've yakked for this period going through this bulletin, I want to pause and let Eric Mele make some comments before we talk about some more specifics. If you're still there, Eric.
I am. I'm just trying to unmute myself.
It's challenging. It is challenging.
It is challenging. You know, I should have used the laptop. I would have had bigger buttons.
Yep. The old Happy 2000.
But yeah, I don't really have much to add to this point as far as, you know, we're just going through what the manufacturer recommends. And I mean, we can disagree or argue about it, but it really doesn't matter because they paid a lot of engineers to come up with this. And there's probably a lot of merit to all of this.
Yeah, but I think also recognize a manufacturer like Copeland, of course, they're going to come up with a really extreme process. And I'm not knocking it at all. I think it's a great process, right? It's a great system, but it doesn't take into account the cost and time involved. So, of course, they're going to have a complicated process, a challenging process, because they don't want warranty compressors coming back, and rightfully so. But where would you see some of the most, like, you know, some of the most common exceptions? Because you work in, essentially, you or have worked in every segment of our industry, from really big commercial, grocery, small commercial, refrigeration, air conditioning. What are some of the things that you typically see or are going to practice?
Well, like you were saying, in smaller systems, it gets a lot harder to be doing stuff like oil changes, multiple filter dryer changes, babysitting a unit for multiple hours. So you're just going to try to have to use your best judgment to get the system running as good as it can. And hopefully if the customer is willing to let you follow up and check pressure drops. But I like to at least try to put in oversized dryers for stuff like that. Cause you know, they might not have you follow up, especially in a smaller system. So if you can put a liquid line dryer that's say like a 30 cubic inch dryer instead of a 16, when you have a nasty burnout, you're probably going to be better off.
Right.
Or at least I feel that way. I could be totally wrong, but I feel like putting in the bigger dryers will allow for more, you know, margin of, you know, making up for the not to the book practice.
And I think you're absolutely right. And this is where practical application comes in. It doesn't hurt to put in a larger liquid line and suction line dryer in terms of capacity. I'm looking now at the Sporlan guide, which they have a really great guide on liquid line filter dryer selection and all that. But when you look at, the volume, cubic inches of desiccant in the system, it's good to have more desiccant, right? More desiccant equals less pressure drop. We want less pressure drop. So if you can put in an oversized dryer with more desiccant, you can fit it in there. Well, then by all means do it. Some people talked about, going ahead and putting it in a location, maybe putting a valve in it so that you can easily swap it out. I think you were the one who talked about this. Maybe it wasn't you, but putting in flares. So that way you can easily swap out a flare dryer or just other methods for easily servicing and swapping dryers, especially if you know you are going to be coming back.
Yeah, you can definitely take advantage of flare dryers in a smaller situation where you know you're going to be back. I don't like leaving them forever, although, there's definitely flare fittings that hold up over time. But if you add a valve, because if you have like a condensing unit, you already have one valve, so you really only have to add one other valve.
Right.
And you'll have an access port there, so you can just, shut the unit off, or if it will pump down. But either way, you could shut the unit off and close your valves and then pump what's out of the dryer into the low side by briefly operating it again and then replacing your dryer, and you don't have to pull a vacuum on the whole system. It's especially helpful if it's a package unit.
Yeah, exactly. One thing I wanted to, as I'm looking at this, I just have this guide up just so you can see, how you can find this information. Cause a lot of people, they're not used to looking at these guides. But looking at the volume of desiccant, different sizes here, it also references things like what HH means, because a lot of people have that question. It indicates this charcoal style core for wax removal and cleanup after hermetic motor burnout. So specifically, Sporlan is telling you this is designed for burnout. But if we go back to what Emerson said, they don't want you leaving an HH in there. They want you taking it back out. And putting in your standard EF style later on. And so, these are all things that if you don't know, either you won't put in an HH after a burnout, and so you're missing out on that. I wish Joe was here, because I'm sure he's going to have some take on this that I'm not thinking about. He's always very detailed. But, if you don't know that, you're going to potentially put the wrong thing in. This is talking about, again, you go to your different refrigerants in order to select specific dryers for specific refrigerants at specific capacities. Every manufacturer, every reputable manufacturer is going to have these sorts of guides that you can go through in order to help you select. Here we're talking about, our reversible heat pump filter dryers, your bi-flow style dryers. A lot of people have asked, can you put a bi-flow dryer and a straight cool? And the answer is yes, you can, but now you've got more size and you're not getting as much bang for the overall physical size that you're putting in here. So as much as possible, use a straight cool dryer and straight cool, and use a bi-flow only when you need to use a bi-flow. And then obviously, on bigger systems, if you are going to do a burnout, if it is a bigger system and you don't have a core dryer in place and it is a burnout, putting a core shell in place and swapping cores is going to be your best bet, both on your liquid and your suction side. And again, we're getting kind of extreme here, but if you go to a big system, a large, maybe 20 ton system, something like that, and it doesn't have a shell in there, then that's probably going to be a good idea if you can make it fit. And again, this is all just a matter of quoting properly. A lot of people get really worked up because they're like, well, the customer's not going to want to pay for this. Well, if you're putting it in your quote, if you're building it in, these multiple trips and these swaps and all this, and it is actually a thoughtful approach in order to prevent future compressor failure, well, then I think the customer will pay for it, because we're in a world now, and I think we got to be pretty practical about this. If you're changing your compressor, a lot of times you're doing it because it's under warranty, it's under 10 years old in sort of the residential space, or it's a big expensive system. So if it's a big expensive system, well, then this babysitting and these additional steps make sense and should be built into the quote. If it's warranty, well, then you're the one who's going to eat the cost if you have to keep going back. So building it in and doing some of these additional steps makes sense because you're saving the company money by making sure that you don't have to go back. I want to pause here while I'm saying this again, though, because what I've seen happen a lot is that people will have a burnout and then they put a new compressor in, it fails after a year or something, and they assume that it's due to improper burnout cleanup, which it could be. But it could also be because whatever system condition that existed that took out the first condition, the first system still exists in the second system, whether it's low airflow causing floodback, whether it's high superheat, high compressor superheat causing overheating, whether it's flooded start because of it's supposed to have a crankcase heater and it doesn't, or it should have some sort of a you know, liquid line shutoff or something of that nature to prevent those flooded starts. And so looking at things like your long line guidelines, if you have a long line application, looking at proper trapping, you know, is it possible that on startup you have liquid coming down your suction line and hitting your compressor, or liquid condensing inside your compressor in the first place? Those are all things that you should look at to prevent this from recurring in the first place before you even get to the conversation about burnout, taking care of your burnout. So I want to address now, and we'll talk more about some, you know, more practical things you can do, but I want to address some of the most common questions that we get. One of them being acid scavenger, acid away, these sorts of products that you put into a system that are designed to neutralize acids. And some of them will talk about neutralizing acids and, you know, turning them into salts, and some, you know, just different approaches. Oh, Joe's here, so I'm going to let Joe in real quick here. But Eric, I want your thought on it. Do you have any particular take on any of these acid neutralizing or scavenging type products?
I don't really have anything meaningful, because some people swear by them, some people say don't put them in the system, and I don't really have any sort of case study to defer to as to the effectiveness of them.
Yeah. One of the listeners, I want to just quickly address it. He said the system has to be clean, and that is a really good point. And this goes back to what we were talking about in the last live stream, is that anything that causes high compression ratio is bad for the compressor. And so look at those things first. And that can be issues with airflow on the inside. It can be issues with airflow on the outside. Dirty condenser, dirty evaporator. Dirty condenser drives head pressure up. Maybe, you know, improper placement of your condenser or fan blade. On the inside, it could be improper setup. If it's variable speed, if it's a commercial system, it could be improper, you know, setup of the belt or the shivs or all those sorts of things. But now I want to jump over to Joe because he's here and I'm so happy. How's it going, Joe? Uh-oh, you're still muted. Oh, no. Oh, no, I can't hear you. Oh, no, this is a disaster. You're really nervous and scared. Oh, there you are. Oh,
okay.
There you are.
I tried to unmute it and my screen, like, blinked out.
Did it? All right. But how you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm good. So we've already talked a little bit about HH dryers. If we look up at the Sporlan guide, I want to read what it says, because I mean, I'm sure you've probably already read this, but you've got something to say about HH. And before you do, I want to read their definition. HH indicates a charcoal style core for wax removal and cleanup after a hermetic motor burnout. So what are your thoughts?
Well, what's the charcoal good for, though? A burnout, because you got a bunch of like charcoal in the system, kind of.
You mean the carbon?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it specifically says for wax removal, and this comes down to like what it's, because I mean, so when you have that high temperature arc, there are wax can be a byproduct of it.
In my understanding, wax was more of low temperature compressors where it was the oil breaking down and forming wax, not really necessarily.
Yeah, but wouldn't the oil break down couldn't the oil break down and cause wax just due to that high temperature event, a single high temperature event?
I'm sure it could. I've never seen like a, and I'm not, you know, Mr. Burnout or anything, but I've never noticed like a waxy buildup. It's usually just like black carbonized oil.
Yeah. And stinky acid.
And acid. Yeah. So my point is to include charcoal in the media. They have to take stuff out to fit it in there. So they're going to take some of the good, like activated alumina, which is the neutralizing part of it, out to put in the charcoal. And I think you'd be better off with a regular dryer that has the most desiccant and the most activated alumina, or, you know, whatever. That's just off the top of my head.
Activated alumina is just the desiccant, right? I mean, that's just for water.
Well, no, there. So the that's the acid part of it, I think.
I don't know about that. I want to look at, because there are actually specific acid mitigation. Reflux. I'm literally doing a Google search right now as I'm on a live stream. But you know, this is what we call Socratic learning. You know, we learn together. We explore things. That's what we're doing right here. Okay, hold on here. We're going to look up, because I don't think HH is the only option either. I have seen something else. You think it is? You think it's just HH and EK?
I've never seen anything else. I've seen like just a pleated filter, but that's...
Right, like basically nothing. Yeah. And that's what you do a lot. Either you pull it out completely or you put in one of those types, which basically just, it becomes a screen at that point. Let's see here. I'm looking at, I'm trying to find a little bit more.
Well, it was saying it there. The molecular sieve is the desiccant.
Oh, you actually see the screen too. Okay. That's good.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Let's see here.
And while Brian Googles this, or does this distract you if I talk?
No, I want you to talk. I just don't want to have to talk while I'm trying to read, because then I just say.
I prefer, if you're going to use an Emerson dryer, I prefer a biflow as opposed to a one-way, even on regular straight cools.
Okay, why?
Do you know why? Because the one ways are beads, and the biflows are solid core dryers.
For not Emerson. Always. I mean, it's not. That's always. Not true of every brand.
No, that's I'm saying Emerson. Brand. I said Emerson. Yeah. Oh, you I said Emerson. If you're going to use Emerson dryers.
Okay.
The Emerson one ways are beads with fiberglass. It's just, to me, it's a little cheaper made.
Okay. Molecular sieve is the water capacity. Okay, you're right. Molecular sieve, greater water capacity, and activated alumina is the acid removal. Interesting.
Right. And that's how I understood it. So to add the charcoal, they're going to have to take some of that good stuff out. So in my opinion, if you're dealing with acid and, you know, the nasty carbonized oil, I think you'd be better off with just a regular dryer.
Okay. And because, so one thing in the Emerson guide, it doesn't say that you should use an HH. Let's just make sure that I'm correct about that. I don't think it does. It says that you should replace the liquid line filter dryer with an Emerson EK of the normally recommended size, but it doesn't specifically say that you should originally put in an HH. And so in terms of wax, I mean, I think, you are right. I mean, you're going to get more wax from long-term operation, overheating. So long-term overheated compressor operation is where you're going to see more wax, is my understanding. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And then you're actually, and so then the result of that is going to be things like plug dryers with wax or plugged, TXVs, valves, strainer screens, that sort of thing. And so at that point, then putting in an HH might make more sense. But I think across the board, we recognize that keeping an HH in for an extended period of time is not the design. So you shouldn't put an HH in and then leave it in. That's basically what it's saying here in the Emerson guide, is that once you're done, you need to go back with an EK. So anyway, okay, cool. What's your take on acid scavenging and inhibition products? I mean, I'm going to give my take once we get through both of you guys.
Man, I mean, it's been used since like the dawn of time. Is it really that bad? I mean, I get what like John Pastorello would say.
which, by the way, I invited him to this call. Couldn't make it.
But and I could probably paraphrase what he would say is that, so it's...
or what he has said, the podcast. Sorry. So we're not just making it up, but yeah, go ahead.
Right, no, I wouldn't.
You wouldn't
do that, but so like to neutral, like we all deal with, do you have a swimming pool, Brian?
No, I do not. What do you think I am, okay. Rich?
Do you have a hot tub?
No, I do not.
Okay. Well, I'm sure you've like had like one checked before, the pH in one before or something. And like, if you want if your pH is low, it's acidic. If the pH is too high, what's the opposite of acid? It's alkaline or something.
Yep. Yep.
It's so if you put this stuff in like acid away, it's a high alkaline. It's kind of like a salt, if I'm not mistaken.
Right.
And it's going to kind of react with the acid and hopefully form, you know, if there's a right amount of acid for the right amount of acid away, then it'll neutralize and be okay. The pH will be good.
Right.
But if you put like acid away and the bottle always says like add entire bottle.
Right.
You know?
Right. I mean, what else are you supposed to do? Like, you're supposed to, you know, measure the internal oil capacity of the particular system you're working on.
It's not that hard. Realistic. I mean, it's not that hard. It'll say it right on the compressor, you know, when you replace it.
Yeah.
But,
well, for people like me who can't read, it could be challenging. Okay. Don't judge.
Right.
Yeah. Anyway.
Man, how have you made it this far in life?
I don't know. You're really like, good scamming skills. I mean, that's honestly what it is.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Keep going.
But if there wasn't very much acid and you put a bottle of acid away in, it could leave the, you know, system like on the opposite end of the scale from acidic. Like, and I'm not honestly, that would be interesting to dive deep with John. Maybe he has. What actually is the, what happens when the system's like too alkaline?
Yeah. Erosion. I mean, I would imagine you would.
Would it be?
Erosion, yeah.
Would you like start to erode? And that's the same thing with acid, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
I think the idea is that the properties, you lose some of the lubricating properties of the oil too, if I remember correctly. Yeah, and again, I'm remembering back to, we did a whole podcast on just this exact topic.
Mm-hmm.
And so I should probably put a link to that in the notes once we put this live, once the live stream's
done. On an aside note, I have put a few drops of acid away into my vacuum pump after evacuating a nasty burnout system. Have you ever evacuated a burnout and then you forget about your vacuum pump and it destroyed it?
No.
Have you done that yet?
Mm-mm. You have?
No, I have. Yeah. It turned the inside to just to rust.
Really?
Yeah. So
interesting. Cause I wouldn't think that acid would really make it inside of your pump.
It will.
But how?
Yeah, when you're doing, because you replace the compressor on a really nasty burn with the high acid.
Right.
And then you're going to like suck it through the vacuum pump. Yeah, all the remaining acid in the system.
But it's not, you're not all sucking the acid. You're not sucking
through
the pump. You're sucking air and moisture through the pump.
But
I guess the moisture. Okay.
Yeah. Well, no, it's in there. You know, if you think about it, like you're now
thinking about
all the acid that's like in the lines, in the coil, in the condenser coil, you're going to suck it out through your pump.
Not if it's solid. You're not, solids don't make it out using a vacuum pump.
No. Acid's not, it's like a vapor or something.
Okay. I buy that. I buy that it could, you know, it combines with.
Check the comments. I can't see the comments.
I can see the comments.
I'm sure people are agreeing.
No, nobody. I really don't think this is a real problem, but that's okay. I think more likely that it's like moisture and then the moisture gets into your pump and sits there. I mean, I've definitely had that happen. If you ever, this is always.
Yeah.
On a quick note here. If you ever do the demonstration where you put water in a vacuum chamber and you pull the vacuum on it to show the kids, hey, look, kids, it's boiling, you know, and then you leave your pump afterwards and don't change the oil, it will jack up your pump seriously. Mm-hmm. Because you've just pulled a bunch of water vapor into your oil and then that creates corrosion and all that stuff. So
I would recommend to borrow your friend's vacuum pump
for that test. Yes, borrow your friend's or use your Harbor Freight pump that you've been wanting to test that purpose. Yes. Joel Becker says that he thinks that the acid is in the oil, not vapor. I have Joel Becker on my side.
Joel. Gas isn't only in, so okay, Joel. Is there any oil left in the entire system left behind?
Of course.
Okay. Enough said.
What do you mean enough said?
You're gonna like start to pull the fumes out of the oil as you vacuum it.
Well,
and the acid is gonna come out.
I mean, your oil's not boiling. You're gonna pull any refrigerant or any moisture out of the oil.
Yeah.
And so to the extent that acid can combine with the refrigerant and the moisture, then yes. Anyway, I feel like we've really gotten on the side. I'm going to share my thoughts on acid.
I'm going to put acid away in my vacuum pump a few drops after I do a nasty system. I may run a little bit through my recovery machine, but you don't have to.
Mm-hmm.
You don't
mm-hmm.
have to. Mm-hmm. We won't.
Here's my take on acid scavengers, acid away, all that. Okay. My take is I put it right beside leak sealants in terms of its use. And that's because I think in both cases, they almost certainly do work under certain conditions and under certain circumstances. And they almost certainly can make things worse under certain circumstances. And the problem that I have with their use, especially for a standard kind of residential service tech, is that we don't discern which is which. Either you're a guy who uses acid scavenger and acid away, or you're not. And either you're a person who puts leak stop or leak sealants in a system, or you're not. And I don't like that. I think we would have to be a lot more thorough in order to know. And so I just stick with what Emerson says, which is use liquid line dryers, pull good vacuums,
mm-hmm.
full stop. I will add to it though, on a really nasty burnout, you can use pipe wiper, at least to get your suction line fully cleared. And then you can use, if you're going to go ahead and we've done this before in really bad circumstances, you can use pipe wiper to clear your suction line, and then you can flush your evaporator. Go ahead.
I would recommend to use a chemical flush in conjunction with the pipe wiper.
Yes. No, and that's
fine. Don't try to put a pipe wiper through a coil.
No, right. So anybody who's listening, so I don't like seeing anybody put any sort of chemical flushes in condenser coils, because there's no real point. I mean, a condenser coil has liquid moving through it anyway. And so I just don't think you're not going to get that much solvent through that condenser coil to effectively get everything out of it anyway. And once you start it up, you're moving liquid through it. And so I just don't think, I don't think it's likely that your condenser coil is going to be super full of acid by the time it's all done. It's really the dryer is going to be what picks that up.
And I think it's very likely you're going to leave a lot of the flush in the coil. You're
not going to be able another, to do that. Right. Another concern. So if you take an evaporator coil out and you flush it, and then you pull, then blast nitrogen through it, and then pull a good vacuum on it. What?
Even then you're going to trap a lot of that flush. It's going to be hard to get that back out of the coil.
I don't know. Again, like I can say, I think in extreme cases, that's the only time I would use flush or mm-hmm. use flush chased by a pipe wiper. Mm-hmm. So flush chased by a pipe wiper is a beautiful, beautiful thing. If you've never done it before, I mean, it's just the most satisfying thing out there. Is that what you
done
do?
It?
Have I done it? Yeah, absolutely.
I do it on every residential change out.
Yeah, so do we.
Do you pipe wiper and flush?
Yeah. Well, I don't know about flush every time. I mean, again, when I say that we do it every time, like we've got installers, that I don't watch every time, but that would be what I would prefer. And mm-hmm. not a lot of flush. And we're talking a small amount of flush chased by a pipe wiper I love that process.
If we're talking about pipe wipers, I've developed a new technique with the pipe wipers.
Let's hear it.
Shoot a pig in like the suction line.
Not an actual pig, a wiper. All right.
Okay.
Okay.
Go ahead. Wiper.
Yeah, a wiper.
And then pour the flush in, and then put another one in, and kind of trap the flush between the two wipers. What do you think of that?
It just seems like completely unnecessary.
Oh, I knew you'd say that. No, but actually it's gonna, because if you put the flush in and then you chase it with the pig, the flush is going to kind of like sit in the bottom of the pipe still.
Mm-hmm. Have you actually done this?
Yes.
And it works. Yes. It works well.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like it. Yeah.
I mean, I'm fine with it. I think we're going into overkill town here.
Well, but, that's my middle name.
That is your middle name. Yes. It is Joe Overkill Town Shearer.
Mm-hmm.
Joseph, actually. Sorry. Good. Okay. So those of you who haven't used pipe wiper before or who don't have any idea what it is, Google the YouTube, or don't Google it, go on YouTube and search pipe wiper and you'll find all kinds of great videos. And they're a lot of fun. It's very satisfying, very high on the satisfying side of things.
You'll find kinked line set, suction lines
too. Yes, actually. And that is a really good, yeah, that is actually a really good use of it, as you will find if you have kinks, and it will not get stuck. People always say, oh, it's going to get stuck. It won't. You can blow it back out the other way. Have you ever had one get stuck?
Yeah, a lot. Oh, well, several times, yeah.
Completely stuck.
And kink. Yeah, completely. It whistles.
You get it back out.
No. I thought you meant, have I got it stuck trying to go one way and had to blow
it
back
out? Right. Backwards. I'm saying, have you completely gotten it stuck so you cannot get it back out again? Because that's what people are afraid of. Mm-hmm. That's what even Eric Mele even says that. He's like, oh, I'm not going to put that in there. Yeah. It's going to get stuck. And he talks in that voice for some reason.
I do talk in that voice, but okay, we replaced a line set the other day, but if we would have tried to pipe wiper this, you tell me if you think it would have got stuck. It was an air handler on a stand and the line set went underground. It was 7/8 down to the, down under the base of the stand. And then it was squished into 1 1/8 and then underground. And then before it came out from underground, it was squished back to 7/8 again. So if you would have shot a pipe wiper down that 7/8 pipe that went into that bigger 1 1/8 pipe, it would have been 7/8 on both ends. You think it would come out?
It would have come out. I guarantee it.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to
test it. I guarantee it.
Now, let's say it was 1 1/8 pig. Like, I personally use some 1 1/8 on 7/8 because it goes through. Now, if it were to get, you know, let's say you had 1 1/8 and you sent 1 1/8 plug through it and it was 7/8 and they just did a terrible reaming job, you know, you may really have to put the pressure to it. Interestingly enough, the smaller ones are harder to get through than the larger ones, which I thought would be the other way around.
Yeah, because there's more, it can just travel around it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The smaller ones are, they'll get stuck a little more. And you'll really, you know, have to jack the pressure up to it. And then, boom, watch out.
How's that?
The other end. Boom.
Just like that. Yeah.
Well, yeah, kind of.
And if they get stuck, you just go back the other way. That's the point. Mm-hmm. Anyway, enough about how much I love pipe wiper, because I do love it a lot. And you can buy it through SureTech Tools now, which is actually kind of nice.
The original?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Mm. There's only one original, Joe. There's only one pipe wiper. Yeah. Okay. So, all right. In terms of the acid scavengers, acid aways, all that sort of thing, I'm of the school of thought that they are helpful in certain cases. I'm also of the school of thought, because one of the comments was, we got somebody who's a little angry right now. I'll read the edited version of what he just said. That these products probably do work in certain cases. I have used them. It's not like you put the stuff in, it's going to blow the system up. But again, I just think for standard practice, it's best to follow what the manufacturer says. In terms of flushes, I'm not a fan of flushes, because you don't want to, and the reason why I'm not a fan of flushes is you don't want to leave any flush in the system. Leaving flush in the system is not good. And there's some manufacturers who have come out and said that they don't want you using it at all. There was a period where some manufacturers did allow for it. In terms of flushing line sets, if you're going to reuse an existing line set, I just don't think there's anything better than using a small amount of flush and chasing it with a pipe wiper. And we've tried a lot of different things. Some people will say, why not just use nitrogen? Because it doesn't do anything. That's why. I mean, it doesn't, like, if there's solid stuff in your lines, flushing with nitrogen is rarely going to get anything out unless you actually have a complete liquid seal of oil or something like that. Do you disagree, Joe? You're making a I disagree face.
No, I agree.
Yeah. It just doesn't.
I was in the, yeah.
So if you blast through nitrogen, just see what comes out. I mean, just do the see what comes out test. Do some with flush.
I'll go as far to say it's just squirting flush through the line is about as useless as nitrogen.
Yeah, it is. Because by the time it gets out the end, it's evaporated and nothing comes out.
Yeah. If nothing comes out, you didn't get anything out.
Right. It's pretty obvious. Yeah. Take a rag, take a bucket, try the different methods, see what comes out. And you'll find with pipe wiper with a little flush, you get a ton out. So the HVAC dude says, pipe wiper 1980 called and says, this is all cuss word. put in so many systems without flush, still ripping everything, is a fugazi in life is crazy. So I don't understand that last part, HVAC dude. When we say putting in systems without flushing, that most cases it's not going to make a difference. I mean, that's true, because in most cases your line set doesn't really have anything in it anyway, right? You'll do flush with pipe wiper, and a lot of times you're not going to get much out. But there's a lot of cases, especially in systems that did have burnouts, or in systems where there was not a proper vacuum pulled in the past, or in systems that, especially if they had low airflow, low suction velocity, you will get oil and crap out of them. And that's an indication that, you know, you didn't want that in there. Like leaving that in there, is it going to cause the system to blow up? This is the thing that I always get that makes me laugh, is that there's very few things that are going to make the system explode 5 minutes after you start it up. You know, a lot of guys are like, oh, I never pulled a vacuum my whole life and I never had a problem. Well, does never had a problem mean that your compressor failed after 8 years when it might have failed after 15? Or does it mean that it blew up in the first 5 minutes? Because it's not going to blow up in the first 5 minutes just because you didn't pull a vacuum or didn't get the lines clear. So, you know, it's always a compared to what situation. Our goal should be to do the very best we can by our customers so the systems don't just last the next year, but they last for a long time after that. That's the goal. Sharky says flush evaporates, doesn't it? Yeah. And almost all these flushes, without exception. And there are, when I say without exception, I think like pro flush tends to stay a little bit more liquid, than some of the other options, but especially some of the early ones. I mean, they really, had pretty low boiling temperatures, or seemed to. They were very volatile and they would disappear, you know, really quickly after you shot them down the line. Out of curiosity.
Yeah, that RX-11 stuff is terrible.
Yeah. Just, you know. And I'm sure if you were testing it on really small lines in a really small system, it might show results. But for what we do, shooting it down a 7/8 suction line, you just don't get anything out. So just do the see what you get out test. So what product do you tend to like to use when you use a flush with pipe wiper, Joe?
Yeah, the Pro Flush. I was
agreeing. Yeah, same by us. That is our favorite product.
And flushing line sets with the pipe wiper, in the words of my good friend Forrest Gump, you never know what you're going to get.
Exactly. And so let's talk about this. What have you gotten out of suction lines? Anything especially interesting?
Suction lines is mostly a little bit of black, but mostly oil, but the liquid lines are by far the worst. And you know, some that you think, you know, the system didn't have a compressor failure, still running, you're just changing it out, you think it's not going to be bad at all, there is terrible. And other ones where you're like, man, this unit's had three compressors in it, we're really going to get a lot of nasty stuff out of this one. And it actually isn't that bad. So you just never know until you start doing it. And I will say the liquid line is by far the worst. And usually you send the first one through with the flush and you don't get much out, because I think the flush kind of like starts to break it down. And then the second, third, and then, you know, I just keep going until it's clean. That's when it really starts to come out dirty.
I am actually surprised that we do get stuff out of liquid lines, though, because it has fairly high liquid velocity this whole time. It's just surprising to me that there would be anything in there, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe like while the system's operating, it's kind of clings to the walls. Velocity. What's that?
It's kind of clinging to the walls, kind of like our arteries and stuff, you know?
Yeah, right. I mean, and that's true. But definitely that's a case where if operating all this time with high velocity liquid moving through it didn't clear it out, then putting a little flush through it by itself or putting some nitrogen through it certainly isn't going to clear it out. Mm-hmm. That's
because it takes like, you know, up to 10 times to get a nasty one clean with the pipe wipers.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, the POE oil will clean that off.
You know? Exactly. And that's really key point to make here. And this is kind of an old timer conversation. A lot of old timers say things like, well, I didn't, you know, I used to just purge and go, or I never did any of this stuff. Well, that was when we had a very forgiving oil that didn't really scrape everything out with mineral oil. When you put refrigerant with POE oil in, that POE oil does act as a solvent and does pull all that junk off and throws it in your line dryers, throws it in your screens and your valves and your compressor and all that stuff. That's proven. Anybody who's done gas changes from mineral oil or AB oil over to POE, you know that systems that ran for years and years and didn't have plug screens or anything, all of a sudden everything starts getting trashed up, and it's because that POE is stripping all that stuff off. So that's undisputed. And it's a lot of the reason why things you could get away with before you really can't get away with now.
And that will apply to changing our compressor in an R22 machine these days. And there's no way you're going to be able to flush that. You're just going to have to kind of be prepared. I actually did have one that plugged a dryer 24 hours later because it just cleaned all that nasty black stuff out of the condenser, the line set,
right,
and everything.
Explain what you're saying there, because I think a lot of people don't realize this.
Yeah. So any compressor these days has POE oil in it, not just 410A. So you're doing the same thing when you put a new compressor in an old R22 unit. It's the same thing as putting 410A in, same oil. So
yeah, a lot of people,
unless you drain it out. Yeah. Unless you, you know, you really don't want to have that happen and you drain out the POE and put mineral in it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have done that, but you know, my middle name is what?
Overkill, Joe Overkill, Overkill Shearer. Yeah. 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 And so this is a good point, is that if you swap to what Joe just said, I'm going to say it again, because I think some of you may have missed it. If you swap a compressor on a system that previously had mineral oil in it, it's a good point, good possibility that that new compressor is going to come with POE oil in it. Which means that now this system has POE oil in it with mineral oil. A lot of people believed when we first went to 410A, that the reason why you had to replace copper for a while, everybody was, you always have to replace copper. Every time you got to replace copper. And that's because a lot of people wrongly believed that mineral oil and POE oil created some like caustic chemical reaction when they mix, and they don't. There's people putting POE on top of mineral oil all the time nowadays. That's not the problem. The problem is if the old system was wet and dirty and now you put POE oil in it, now you've got all kind of heck on your hands. That's the churched up version. All kind of heck on your hands. Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, let's back it up a little bit and just talk again about, because I think some people have gotten lost about what we're talking about here. We're talking about best practices when you have a burnout. And I want to cover, so burnout is, you got a shorted or grounded compressor. What do you do next? And so I want your take on this, Joe, because I know you're probably going to be of the most extreme. So let's give a scenario. Let's say you have a got a Lennox heat pump. So I choose a Lennox heat pump because they have among the most difficult liquid line dryers to deal with. You have a Lennox heat pump and it's got a shorted compressor. When you hook up to it, you don't smell anything. So you don't get a pungent odor, but you know it's grounded. I mean, it's confirmed the thing's grounded. What is your procedure? What do you do next? What do you quote the customer? What's your process?
I would probably quote the customer if I don't smell anything. And I actually have to do this Friday. So I didn't quote to do. No, it's a comfort maker, but it is grounded. It smells maybe just a little bit. It's hard to maybe decipher just contamination or acidic, but I didn't quote suction line dryers. But I did go ahead and get an accumulator for it.
Yeah.
So not going to do a reversing valve. I'm going to do an accumulator. But once I get the compressor out, that will confirm if you've got something to worry about, because you can see right down the suction line.
Right. You can dump that oil out and see what you got.
You can dump it out and see what you got.
Yeah.
I don't know that, honestly, I don't think. In fact, I would say suction dryers will not make black oil clean. It's going to pass that black right through it.
Right.
So just because the oil is black, I don't know that it's 100% necessary to have to think that you must put a dryer in, because the dryer is not going to make that oil any less black as it goes through.
If we go back to what Emerson said, you know, Emerson doesn't say, they don't give you some standard of when you need to use suction dryers other than if you smell the odor. So they literally in their guide use odor as the indication of, let's see if I can find the exact quote, because I want to make sure I'm not saying something stupid here. I'm going to go back and share this again so that we can read along together. You know, we'll have Brian's fun read along time, which is everybody's favorite out there in the industry. We love reading together. Let's see here. When the motor burnout occurs in the compressor, the resulting high temperature arc, we know that. Let's see here. Let's go to step. It's saying take a sample oil from the replacement compressor and seal in a small glass bottle for comparison purposes. They're telling you to just kind of compare color, basically. And again, a lot of this refers to systems where you can easily access the oil system and isn't going to apply to residential systems. But there is a part here where it talks about odor. I'm going to see here. I'm going to hit Control F and hit the word odor. There we go. Check the odor. There it is. After completion of step 7, allow the unit to operate for 48 hours. Check the odor. If the color is discolored, has an acid odor, is acidic, or if the moisture, so it does list all of them. So it's saying if it is discolored, it's telling you to swap the filter dryers. So I think they are kind of contending that it will physically clean up the appearance of the oil. One thing to make sure that we're clear about, though, is that a lot of this is dilution too. I mean, because when you take a compressor out, you're taking out the majority of the system's oil. And then whatever's left over is going to mix together with the new compressor oil and then, cycle through the line dryers. So anyway, that's just back to what Emerson says. You can keep going with your story now, Joe. You're still muted.
Where was I? So new accumulator.
Let's pause at accumulator. Okay. If you have an accumulator in a true burnout, so you know it's a burnout, swapping an accumulator is a really smart thing to do because an accumulator holds a lot of oil. It's right before your compressor. And so if there is oil in there or if you have a plug screen or anything like that, it can cause a lot of heck. They're not expensive and they're easy to swap when you're doing the compressor anyway. So it just really makes a lot of sense. Keep going.
Yeah. And mine's not really a super bad burn, but I just figure, like you were saying, it's really easy to do and you'll know that it's nice and clean. And, I kind of feel like an accumulator might help kind of trap any bits of anything that might, be remaining as well.
Yeah.
And plus accumulators is kind of like we were talking about the pipe wiper. You never know what you're going to get. It could be like half full of oil and it surprises you. Most of the time it's not, but there's been a couple of times where that thing probably had 10 ounces of oil in it.
Which could be an indication of a problem. I mean, that could be that the screen just isn't allowing enough oil back through, and that could have been what killed the compressor in the first place.
Yeah.
It can happen.
It's just one of those things. Unfortunately, there's no way to know how much oil's in it because they seem to kind of frost up when you're evacuating and make you think there's going to be a lot in it. And then that was just a very small amount. So,
yeah.
Don't always do it. It's probably one of those good practice things. If I'm not going to do a suction line dryer and it is, I would feel better about doing at least a new accumulator in it. I always drain the old oil out and measure it. Cause I do like to know if there's a lot left somewhere else in the system.
Yeah.
Occasionally there's been I remember one job where there was zero oil in the compressor and I thought for sure it's gotta be somewhere. Right. So I cut the entire evaporator out. Not in there. Condenser's not in there. Flush the lines is not in there. I'm like, well, I found out what killed the compressor, but
it was shipped.
How did this thing have no oil in it?
How old was it?
It was old enough that it didn't like just happen. It was probably a 2008 or nine unit, and this was like in 2018, 2019, something like that.
Yeah, that's weird.
So anyway, yeah, that was weird. But I do like to measure the oil, look at it. It's probably going to be black even when they're not highly acidic. The oil generally is still pretty black. So then after that, heat pumps are a little tricky because it's hard to really, I do like to kind of blow nitrogen through everything just to get any if there's a huge oil log in it somewhere, hopefully you'll get some of that out, but again, with the sometimes heat pumps, the reversing valve can kind of get stuck halfway between and you're putting it in the discharge line. It's kind of just coming out of the, so you can't quite figure out where it's going.
Right.
So that is a challenge.
I mean, this is just reality of being a technician. Like, you have to think through these things, and everything's not always ideal. One question for you quickly, and this isn't directly related to burnout, but when you pull a compressor, or I guess I should say when you diagnose a failed compressor, do you weigh out the charge at that time to see if it was potentially overcharged or undercharged as a cause?
Yeah, that's easy to do. Yeah.
Yeah.
Just throw it on a scale at the end. That's kind of usually what I do, is I'll just throw my bottle on a scale, write it down, recover it. While I'm doing other stuff, throw the bottle back on the scale. It's not going to really like stop what you have to do, just throw it on the scale when you're pulling a vacuum or something like that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm referencing when you actually do the initial diagnosis though. When you do the original diagnosis, cause this is a practice, I think it was, Stephen Raritan talked about this. When you go and find a compressor that has a failure, go ahead at that time and just weigh the charge out, because at that point you're going to have to do a major system repair anyway. And then you can see, is the system significantly short or overcharged? And that will give you a pretty good indication of what might be wrong. If it's overcharged, look at airflow, look for restrictions, you know, that kind of thing. If it's undercharged, then, you know, you need to find where the leak is before you go quoting a compressor. You don't like it?
I feel like that could, I personally haven't done that. I personally don't feel like that's something I should do. I think you're going to be chasing leaks when the system was just, you know, never charged right or something.
I'm talking significant. You know. I mean, I'm not saying like, yeah, if it's a pound lower overcharged, well, so what? But if the thing has 6 extra pounds of refrigerant in it, or it's got only half of its factory charge, I think there's some.
I just like to see how it runs. You know, I'm like, I'm not going to get down in the what if weeds too much, I feel like, before I've seen how it runs. If that makes sense.
Yeah, but I don't like that, because if the what if it has an evaporator coil leak, and now you quoted the customer a compressor, you went in with a new compressor, and now you're going to see how it runs, and you're going to quote the customer in a, you know, a new evaporator, where maybe they would have chosen a new system if they would have known. That's my problem with it.
Okay, I can see the value in that potential, but. So you get 50% of it out, 50% of the refrigerant out that you should have.
Let's say,
sounds like a long diagnosis call.
If you've got a system that's significantly overcharged, I'm going to likely go ahead and put a new expansion valve in it while I've got it open at that point.
Maybe, maybe not, you know, it could just be simply
overcharged. No, I know, but you're not going to know otherwise, you know, so putting a valve in, valves aren't that expensive when you've already got the system open. So go ahead and put
it in. I just feel like it's a rabbit hole. I feel like it's a rabbit hole.
Yeah, it is. Mm-hmm. I agree.
It's like, you know, reversing valve, we could get into that rabbit hole. We could TXV.
I'm just looking in terms of pumps.
Are we doing indoor and out? It's like, for me, it's a rabbit hole that I just prefer, that I feel better about. I just do. I really do. I want to see how it runs. You know, I'll do a nitrogen pressure test and all that. And yeah, it won't pick up a small evaporator leak. You know, but, you know, I guess maybe you could say I'm doing something wrong by that. If I did do a compressor, it hasn't bit me in the butt enough to where I'm like, I'm never doing that again. I think that's kind of how we all,
if a compressor have to make our decisions, bite you in the butt, then you need to let me know, because that would definitely be a noteworthy diagnosis.
I've seen some compressors almost bite people in the face.
Yes, the butt biting compressor. Eric, I want to hear from you. What do you say? Weigh out the refrigerant on a compressor fault during diagnosis, yay or nay?
It sounds like a good practice, but I've never actually done that.
Okay.
I mean, you do want to look at the rest of the system. You definitely want to look at standing pressure and see, is that in the realm? Because, you know, it is a good indication usually, like,
I mean, that's only going to be an indication if you're completely vapor. I mean, you're essentially flat at that point. So yes, definitely need to connect on a shorter compressor and make sure you've got refrigerant in the thing.
Make sure the condenser fan motor runs.
Yeah. Okay.
Because if you got a shorted compressor, it most likely tripped the breaker. Well, maybe, you know, it went out because of the fan motor and you don't notice. And then you go throw a compressor in and now it's like, oh, your fan motor's bad. You know?
I've had that a couple of times.
So we've got half an hour left and I want to get to some of the key things that people are going to ask. So let's say you do put in a suction line dryer on a residential system, Joe, a heat pump. What do you do? So you got what you would consider to be a significant burnout. And so you're going to put a suction line dryer in it. How do you handle that with the customer and with what you quote?
Typically I'm leaving it, follow up and check it. And I've personally only seen one time in my career, and this was probably like 15 years ago, a unit that had a significant pressure drop across the filter dryer.
We're talking suction line filter dryer now.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, yep. Suction line dryer. I do find that they rot away and they end up being a leaking problem.
Yeah.
So I think it would be a good idea to take it out from that standpoint. Let me ask you this though, Brian, on a heat pump, if you're going to take it out, how would you feel about putting a new accumulator in, flushing the suction line from the accumulator through the reversing valve out the service port of the unit really well, mm-hmm. and putting the dryer in the line set and locking it in cool mode?
Yeah, we do it all the time. Yeah, if we're gonna go back and pull it out, mm-hmm. then that's what we typically do, because it's going to make your life a lot easier than having to go back and, you know, recover the entire charge and everything. At that point you can go, but
it's very, very important that it has a new accumulator and you've spent time flushing the reversing valve and getting everything clean. That's because, going to be, yeah, in front of that dryer.
Correct.
Yeah. Because if you have an accumulator full of nasty sludge,
right,
that dryer on the line set is not going to help you.
Yeah. And that's, and to your point, yes, the accumulator part has always been really important to us. So we've always paid a lot of attention to that. But yes, that's, so what Joe's saying here is, if you imagine, you know, your accumulator is right before your compressor, and if you've got a burned out compressor and you put your suction line dryer at the suction line on the line set outside of the condenser, and you don't address the accumulator, you don't address the reversing valve, you don't address the connecting lines, then there's a significant amount of acid that could potentially make it into the compressor before it gets into that suction line dryer. And if the whole point of installing the suction line dryer in the first place is to catch that, then unless you're actually addressing that separately, then you're not really doing anybody any favors. Technically, the best way to do it is to put your suction line dryer right before your compressor. But sometimes just the room and everything in there makes that exceedingly difficult. I mean, and sometimes you're literally talking about like repiping everything in this giant octopus in order to make it fit. So I think it depends on the circumstances, how difficult it's going to be. And also pump down, you know, in some cases pump down's easy, and in some cases pump down's getting hard too. You know, you got a microchannel condenser, well, you can't pump it down anyway. You're already pulling your recovery machine off, so who the heck cares where you put it, right? If you've got at that point, maybe you'd think about putting in, you know, ball valves or something, or you'd use a flare dryer. I don't know. You know, like what, that wouldn't make any difference anyway. So flare dryer, that was a stupid thing I just said, ignore that. But if you put ball valves in where you could valve it out and actually just recover the amount out of the dryer and, you know, do it there, then, you know, and straight pipe it, then maybe. But just thinking through the application, you know, I feel this is deja vu, Joe. It feels like we've talked about this exact thing, you and I, before. Doesn't it feel like that?
Yeah, I've talked to a lot of, we've probably both talked to a lot of people about it.
Yeah, I'm getting,
especially the HH dryer thing.
Yeah, I don't remember that talking about that with you. But anyway, we know a couple things. We know that if you put an HH dryer in, Emerson wants you pulling it back out and putting an EK in. So that's what they say. We know that if there's a pressure drop outside of the listed acceptable levels on a suction dryer, that you need to replace it or remove it, right? We know that Emerson says that they don't refer to flushes or acid inhibitors or acid scavengers as being the appropriate way to deal with burnout in their systems. We know that a lot of people use those things and probably have fine results, and I don't dispute that they probably do, but I think it's a crapshoot. The question of, on a heat pump, whether you can put it outside, I think there are circumstances you can, like you said, if you replace the accumulator, but you have to make sure the thing stays locked and cool. So if it's the fall and winter's coming, you know, and somebody might want to shift it into heat, well, then that's not going to make sense. If it's in heat mode, that's not going to make sense. You're going to have to put it in between the reversing valve and the compressor at that point. So these are all things, like, people want these really clear cut. I know whenever I talk about this stuff, and I'm getting the comments, you know, I'm getting called a nerd and this is impractical and all this stuff. I get it. It's a lot of rigmarole, right? But I think when it comes to burnout and cleaning it up properly, it's kind of specific to the system, and it's kind of specific to what risks you're willing to take. Because there's a lot of people who would just take the old compressor out, slam a new one in, and move on. You know, and probably in most cases, it's probably going to be fine. But it depends on the extent of the burnout. And, you know, how do you know unless you test? How do you know unless you're paying attention to this sort of stuff? So anyway, thoughts, Eric, Joe, any thoughts?
One thing I want to add is, and I learned this from the podcast you had, I think it was with John Pastorello about compressor burnouts. He said it, like, the inside of the piping gets tarnished from the burnout local to the compressor. And I've done that where I've removed a piece of piping. It's a lot easier on a straight cool unit, but the piece of piping from the suction service valve to the compressor, remove it. And maybe if you're using pipe wipers, you could send one through or just make a new piece. It's a lot harder with a heat pump, but I mean, that line was nasty when I pulled it out, and I never thought about that before, but it's kind of so obvious, right? Like, if you can replace the copper local to the compressor where you can see that it's like got that tarnished layer on it of just nastiness, it's probably a good idea. It's probably worthwhile.
Yeah. And I think it matters a lot. Like, what is the customer trying to get out of this compressor you're putting in? Like, if you're swapping a compressor on a 1 or 2 year old system that you just put in, you better pay attention to everything, because now this customer is going to expect to get 10 plus, you know, operational years out of this. And so be crazy thorough. If you're putting a compressor in, you know, a commercial unit that they're trying to get 5 more years out of it, I think it's a different application. So, you know, it really just depends. It's not like in residential, we're going to be putting compressors in 10-year-old units very often. That's, you know, maybe sometimes, but not often. And if you are, you don't have as high of expectations as you do on a brand new system. But I would say, like, we're kind of dancing around the issue here. This is all important stuff, knowing how to deal with a burnout, knowing what your options are. Of course, your various companies are going to have different policies. Some people are going to swear by certain acid products. Some are going to swear by always going back and pulling out your suction dryers. Some are never going to pull out the suction dryers. Some are going to always try to oversize the suction dryers, which, you know, that's a good practice. But there is no one-size-fits-all solution. But what we do all know is that figuring out what killed the first compressor is really important. So, do you have proper compressor superheat? Is it possibly, you know, experiencing flooded start? Are you following, if it's long lines, are you following the long line guidelines and making sure that you're not experiencing flooded start? Because the one thing we've talked about previously, which is really key, anything that causes that system to have more refrigerant in it than it was originally designed for becomes a pretty significant risk to the compressor. During off cycle, flooded start, flooding during operation flood back during operation, all those sorts of things. Those are significant problems. And a lot of that comes down to, you know, airflow. Once you've got that new compressor in, just test everything. Make sure everything's operating the way it should. Look at your discharge line temperature 6 inches out of that compressor and see if it's within the range that it should be. Just be really, really thorough so that way you don't kill that next compressor, because odds are the reason you're killing it is not actually burnout related. It's related to whatever killed the first one. Would you agree with that, Joe, or disagree? Oh, he's talking to his wife. Would you agree or disagree with that, Eric?
Yeah, if you don't correct what killed the first one, likely it's just going to happen again. I mean, there's been runs of compressors that had problems, but that's more the exception and not the rule.
Yeah.
I thoroughly agree.
Oh, hey, Chad showed up. You broke up there a little bit, Chad. Say it again.
But I thoroughly agree. I've been here the whole time.
I know, but you haven't said anything before. So Chad's a grocery tech, and in grocery, anytime you have multiple compressors manifolded together, where a problem with one can cause problems with the others, or when those compressors are expensive and difficult to replace, like I said at the beginning, more due diligence. You know, it those extra steps that might be super time consuming, but prevent even a small percentage of chance that new compressor could fail again, matters more when the things are crazy expensive and crazy labor intensive to replace. When you're talking residential, you know, everything is a risk, right? Everything we do is a calculated risk to some degree, both for us and for our customers. So we have to try to come up with a protocol that works for the particular situation. Brody asked the question, and I talked about it earlier, but I want to address it. He said non-condensable, it's called, right, Brian? No, non-condensables are air and nitrogen. That's basically the only two non-condensables we deal with in air conditioning, because that specifically means a gas that does not condense, meaning a gas that does not change from a vapor to a liquid. So acids aren't non-condensables. Burned oil isn't non-condensables. Those are solids or liquids or, you know, other things. It's not, those are not non-condensables.
I remember Eric actually showed me a picture where the factory filter dryer inside the condenser actually blew up and all that desiccant went inside the compressor. That's non-condensable.
No, it's not a non-condensable. It's solid contaminant. That's not non-condensable. Non-condensable is a gas that doesn't condense. But yeah, to your point, one of the first major mistakes that I was a part of, and I wasn't the one who did it, but I was riding with a guy, and he put the liquid line dryer, a bead desiccant liquid line dryer, in the discharge line. He pulled out a discharge muffler because the muffler looked like a dryer, and he put in a desiccant dryer and it blew the beads out. Now, some people will actually say that, you know, like some manufacturers actually design for dryers in the discharge line. And sometimes there literally are dryers in the discharge line, but all I know is in that particular case, it blew the desiccant out and really messed up the system. So anyway, have you ever seen that actually happen, Joe or Eric? Desiccant blown out with somebody put a suction line or a liquid line dryer into the discharge line?
Yes. I've seen it also on a liquid line dryer and a liquid line.
It just came apart.
Yep. That's the one Chad was talking about. It was, okay. It was the liquid line dryer. It blew the beads all the way down the liquid line from the condensing unit to the TXV. I believe that's the one he's talking about, but I've also seen where somebody put one in a discharge line and it did the same thing. It blew the beads all throughout the condenser and the liquid line all the way to the TXV.
Yeah. And that's
we're talking about dryers in weird locations, you know, it is acceptable to use a liquid line dryer as a suction line dryer too, by the way. Like if you were working on a small system or something, they're really not much different.
Yeah.
Usually just the line connections.
Right.
So
yeah.
A lot of times I'll have charts for cross-referencing them too.
Yeah, and that's what you want to look for. I mean, I want people paying attention to charts when they're putting in line dryers anyway, to just make sure that, you know, when possible, oversizing them, like Eric talked about. How do you feel about oversizing line dryers, Joe? Do you see any downside there? I can't think of any.
No. I mean, unless it was so massive, it held like 8 pounds of Freon or something.
8 pounds of refrigerant, yeah, yeah. Yeah,
or it starts trapping a bunch of oil.
I don't know how it would really trap too much oil.
If it's horizontal and it's really big and it's in the suction line where you don't have good
velocity
to get it back out. Mm-hmm. I've wondered about that, but sometimes it's the only way to do it.
Yeah, so don't put a giant canister dryer like on a domestic refrigerator or something like that. Mm-hmm. That'd probably be a bad
horizontal
idea.
Or do it vertical.
Do it vertical.
Yeah.
But Delfield uses Danfoss filter dryers in discharge lines on self-contained equipment I've seen from them. So it is out there.
Yeah. No, I've heard that a few times. I haven't seen that one specifically, but there are cases where you'll see and it will say liquid line dryer. And it's like, is this a muffler? Is this a liquid line dryer right in the discharge line? So
it's both,
you know. It is both in that case.
I think they're using it for a screen in this application because it's right before two tiny hot gas solenoids. They're like quarter inch. So those valve seats got to be pretty tiny.
And as long as it's solid core, I'm sure it's fine. It's when it's, you know, desiccant beads and they don't hold up and they end up in the system. And they probably shouldn't do that anyway, my guess is. That's probably a fault, but again, having seen it, you know, it's something that to watch for. Cool. Anything else we're missing here? We've talked about aftermarket flush. We've talked about pipe wiper. We've talked about HH and EK dryers. We've gone through the Emerson guide. Anything else we're missing?
We could talk about the electrical side of it.
Yeah. Okay. That's good. Yeah. Let's do that.
Always new contactor and capacitor on a single phase unit. You know, unless the unit is like 1 year old and the contactor is like beautiful.
Right.
Maybe not, but, you know, it'd be interesting. They tell you to always do a contactor, I guess, because if it was getting a voltage loss across the contacts, it could take out a compressor from low voltage. But I don't know. I've never seen that happen. I feel like it would take out a contactor way before it took out a robust compressor. But yeah, that is, you know, always recommended. And definitely too, you know, anytime you're changing a compressor, check what the new compressor, you know, sometimes it's not the exact same compressor that their unit originally had.
Right.
And you need to make sure that you usually they'll come with, I know Copeland puts a sheet in their boxes that says the sizes for pretty much all the compressors, and it's right on the label too. So just check and make sure you're putting the right size run capacitor for the new compressor.
I'll also add, I think you and I have had this argument before, but I always want you going back in if it requires start gear on a new compressor. I want you putting in factory start gear, factory hard start kit, in applications where you have long line, you know, situations, or if you're on 208 and so you know you're going to have starting issues.
Luck finding that information because they don't list it for scrolls.
I've seen it before. I've definitely seen it before.
I'd love to, because in the Copeland app, it says, you know, NR, like not recommended.
No, I'm talking about, so you'd look at the long line guidelines. Not, this wouldn't be Copeland. This would be the long line guidelines for your a particular OEM manufacturer.
Well, that's usually generic information. And they just have like one start kit, you know, for like maybe 1 to 3 ton. And then maybe some of them, it's the same start kit for all the sizes. It's like, why is it so important then?
You know? Well, so, okay, let me give you an example. So if there's a factory, if there's factory start gear in there, so like on train.
Oh, okay. Okay.
That's more what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Okay. On the aftermarket side, I'm pretty comfortable with Kickstart, you know, those products, if you're in the right range, in certain applications. And again, I know I'm going to get flack for that, but I'm talking specifically if there is a designed factory hard start kit. And you're going back in with a new compressor, go ahead and replace that with the factory hard start kit that it came with. Like if you think of the, a real common one was those Bristols that, you know, those Bristol recips that ran opposite directions in order to stage where it would engage one piston. I forget the specific model, but those had a specific set of start gear. And sometimes if you had the potential relay, you know, stay shut on you, that would cause the failure. And you'd see cases where you'd go back in with a couple compressors and nobody replaced the start gear. So the principle here is put in proper run capacitors and new factory start gear, if possible, when you're going back in, and a new contactor. Pretty much across the board, manufacturers are going to recommend that when you're swapping a compressor. Is it that big of a deal? I mean, probably not, but it's inexpensive. And again, if you are going back in with a new contactor though, make sure that you're using the right one or you're wearing it properly. If you have crankcase heat, and that's something we've definitely talked about in the past and had a really fun time talking about at the symposium.
Also,
you had to mention
talk of our lives. Yeah. I had to mention the symposium. Go ahead, Eric.
Also make sure that the system operates properly, because I've seen situations where, you know, people get a new compressor and they get it running, everything looks great, and they leave because, you know, the temperature was high, they didn't want to cycle the system back off and seen what happens.
Right.
So one time I've seen where a building automation system was not wired to ever shut the compressor off. So the rest of the system would shut off, and it had a pump down solenoid, so it would never freeze, but the compressor would run forever.
Yeah.
So, you know, I just kept doing that until it finally burned up. And I've also heard of a situation where a miswired contactor with a crankcase heater miswired was single phasing a three phase compressor when it would shut back off, and that caused a compressor failure.
Yeah. So yeah, exactly. Running it and as long as you can, getting it to temperature, cycling it off, those sorts of things are key. And again, you know, people's risk tolerance is going to vary depending on the situation. You're working, like I said, big stuff, refrigeration, expensive compressors. You need to actually run it until it cycles or do a follow-up call. In residential, a lot of times we don't do that, but you're just running more of a risk. Jessica said that she worked on a train 18i, which is a two compressor system with a factory hard start. That's a good example. In fact, train on those two compressor systems, they would tell you that if one fails, you had to replace both because it would likely cross-contaminate the oil in both of them. And yeah, if you have one of those fail, definitely change out all the start gear.
I think those have three phase contactors in them.
Do they?
Mm-hmm.
They have a three pole contactor, and I think they use it to bring on the condenser fan no matter which contactor pulls in. And also there's a part of the circuit that there's two run capacitors. And when the big compressor starts, it brings in both capacitors in parallel. And when the small compressor is running, it uses only one of the capacitors.
Yeah, it has the capacitors going through one of the legs.
Yeah, it's been so long since I've worked on one of those. But yeah, it's
me too.
Definitely a case where you really want to look at the start gear on the electrical side. And another thing, just while we're on the topic of the electrical side, be really, really careful when you're working with fuseite terminals. You know, jamming things on and off and just being rough with them because they can easily, it's a weak point in the system. It's literally just a piece of metal going through essentially glass or ceramic, porcelain, whatever it is. And it can easily be damaged if you're too rough with them. And on that front, when we talk about acid or burnouts, a lot of times burnouts are made worse by people keep resetting the dang breaker. Once you have a trip breaker, don't just keep resetting it. Do a really solid visual inspection and then go through and do some basic tests to narrow down where the short is. And then if you want to do one final one, you know, once you actually isolate the compressor to ensure that it is the compressor and that everything else still works, you know, that's fine. But that's once you've already got the compressor isolated, don't go there and keep slamming that circuit breaker on. Because every time you do it, you're creating another arc flash inside that compressor and creating more burnout.
And be super mindful where you're standing and where the compressor terminals are pointing. I've been lucky that's never happened to me, but there's been chances where, you know, you are literally standing right in front of this thing and you're resetting the breaker, you know, really not a smart move.
Yeah.
Especially when it's tripping the breaker and you've got the cover off because you're checking it and you're resetting the breaker and your chest is, you know, a foot away from that, you know, you need to really be more diligent about that, I think, too.
Yeah, both in terms of arc, but then in terms of terminal venting, too.
Yeah.
Thinking about terminal venting. And a lot of people don't realize that, but you can create a terminal venting event when you reset that breaker because you're creating super high current. And if you don't have a great connection on that terminal or, you know, because there's connections on both sides. If you've ever pulled these things apart, you literally have terminals connected on both sides of those, of that fuseite. And so if there's any sort of poor connection that's developed, especially because you had a short, and so there's a lot of stuff going on, acids, and, you know, if you had a mechanical failure that caused it, a lot of times something, you know, horrible happens inside that compressor that then results in the electrical problem. That same thing can result in damage to that fuseite. And so now you reset the breaker and boom, that thing, you know, blows out at you.
My buddy did that on a rooftop unit. So when he had the panel off, the compressor was pointing right at him and it shot out a fireball that melted through his shirt.
That is no bueno. You've had
not a Kalos employee.
No, not a Kalos employee. I was trying to think through the history here. Yeah. So you've had a lot of like friends get injured in horrible ways.
Well, when I say friend, it's really me. I'm just like trying to, you know. No, actually, that was not me, but I digress.
Yeah. Fence Post says, I just like to read these sometimes because I wonder what people are getting at. Are you guys just going to talk about single phase / three phase, i.e. cuss word, no one knows about, or is it just for the educated, if you will? Otherwise, with all due respect, this is boring to anyone else. If you listen back to the beginning, we've talked about essentially everything that we can think of relating to burnout conditions and what you want to think about when replacing compressors. So of course, we're going to talk about a lot of different equipment, because there's a lot of different equipment in our trade. And some people are residential, some people are commercial, some people, you know, it's a lot of different stuff there. So you are free to always shut it off if you're not interested. That is always a right that you have. And I'm sorry that I've, I'm sorry that I've wasted your time. Really am deeply, deeply sorry. What else do we have? What else do we need to cover here? Anything else you can think of?
Gosh, I can't think of anything else.
Pay attention when you're diagnosing just a couple things, because a lot of this goes down to properly diagnosing shorted and grounded compressors. We've talked about this a lot before, but if you're going to use a megometer, megometers only work when measuring to ground. You cannot use them from a leg to leg on a compressor. B, use a megometer that actually gives you a readout that doesn't just light up little LED lights, because scroll compressors will often have a pretty, you know, pretty low measurement to ground, even just under normal conditions. What else was I going to mention about that? Recognize that if you're not using a megometer and you're just using the ohmmeter on, you know, just the scale on a regular inexpensive ohmmeter, a lot of times you're not going to measure to ground, even when it is grounded. And that's just because you're using a very low voltage signal in a very noisy and dirty environment. So once you have a short inside that compressor, there's carbon and all kinds of junk inside there. And so that can result in, you know, making it difficult to measure to ground, even though it is truly grounded. Do you see that much? I mean, I remember, and maybe it was just that my initial multimeter was really crappy, but I remember a lot of cases where you'd have a grounded compressor, meaning it would confirm, you know, if you reset it, it was grounded. And when you isolated it, it didn't trip anymore. But it wouldn't measure on my meter. Have you run into that much?
Yeah, I have to where sometimes, like, you'll check it at first and you don't have anything, and then you reset the breaker and pow, it kind of arcs it one more time, and then you've got it with your meter. I have a older field piece that goes to what's the one past K, because that's not mega ohm, milli ohm.
Yeah, it is,
right? Is it mega?
Yeah, so it goes from kilo, it goes from
K to M on my display.
Yeah
Is that mega
ohm? Giga ohms is next. Yeah, it's okay. Mega.
I thought it was milliohm.
Milliohm would be the other way. Milliohm would be very few.
Okay. Ohm. Okay. Well, I don't
know. Some of those meters, and especially got ones we were using, you know, 10, 15 years ago, they only went to 10,000 ohms.
Yeah.
Yeah, because my meter will show sometimes like a M or a K to ground when it's cold. I usually disregard that. Don't worry about it, especially on scrolls.
Yeah, on scrolls, you are going to measure. Mm-hmm. And that's what Copeland says. I mean, all the way down to 500 K ohms to ground, it can be acceptable under certain circumstances. Now, the advantage of measuring to ground, even on a good compressor, is over time, you can actually look at oil contamination. Meaning the more contaminated your oil, the more you're going to measure a path to ground. And the reason why you do this, for people who don't know, is because this compressor is full of oil and refrigerant. If you ever try to test a compressor that you've dumped the oil out of and there's no refrigerant in it, then you're not going to get that kind of path to ground. It's because you have oil and refrigerant in there that's creating a path from the windings to ground, because the windings have a lacquer on them, but it's very thin. And on scrolls specifically, because they're in a motor down orientation, so the motor's on the bottom, it's immersed in that, and it's really close to the shell. You don't have suspension and a big air gap in between. That's why you are going to see lower ohm measurements to ground. So don't just take one of these mega ohm meters, see a reading and say, it's bad. It's not that simple. And also don't measure leg to leg and see a low ohm measurement and say, it's bad. Because you'll have some compressors, if you go in the Copeland app, where it'll be under one ohm from leg to leg, like from common to run, for example, under one ohm. And that may be what it's supposed to be. From the factory. So your meter could be ringing like crazy. That doesn't mean it's shorted. And that just goes down to, you know, inductive reactants and all that, which is a whole nother story. But if you want to know, you know, use the Copeland mobile app and you can figure out what those resistances are supposed to be when you go into the electrical, which, you know, go into the compressor that you're working on, go to the electrical segment, and it'll tell you what the resistances should be if you're curious about that.
And have good leads on your meters too.
Yes.
Test them, see what, because I have some, I bought really high-end Fluke leads, and they were the worst leads I've ever bought in my life, because they would themselves have like 11 ohms, and then you'd bend the little flexi strain reliefs and it would go up, down, up. And it's like, right. So you really need to be able to trust your meter. And if, you know, if I may plug a really fantastic lead manufacturer, I don't know,
please.
Probe Master USA. They're fantastic test meter leads. They're gold plated. And my meter shows like 0.1, which I've never seen with any other leads. And they're very trustworthy too.
Nice.
So
yeah, I guess a good set of quality leads where you have the alligator clips and just a wide range of ends on them are really nice to have. And to what Joe's saying, always check before you ever use a meter every time, take them, hook them together and make sure that you're measuring near 0 ohms. Because you don't want to be chasing your tail. Do that every time. And coincidentally, you said it was Probe Master?
Yeah, Probe Master.
Probe Master. Mm-hmm. Coincidentally, that's also my dancer name. So it works nicely. Did you say gross?
Yeah.
Well.
But no, when you're checking really low resistance like that and you're adding things up, seeing if it, the math works out, it's just, that's why I brought it up, because if your leads are adding even 1 ohm of resistance, and if it's varying because you're going, the strain relief has a poor connection in there or something, which is more common than you'd like to believe, because I've had it happen multiple times.
Yep.
You'll be chasing your tail trying to get these really low ohm readings to add up and be accurate, when, especially if you're looking at an app telling you what it should be.
Right.
And stuff like that.
Yeah, when it's under 1 ohm, I mean, it's really critical that your leads aren't adding to it, for sure. Cool. Eric, anything else to add?
Not really. I was going to say that's also my dancer name too. You stole my dancer name.
Dang it.
But yeah, leads, check them, because it's about once a year I'm getting really weird stuff going on with my meter and I figure out, oh, my leads are bad. But I'm running crappy fluke leads.
Yeah.
And I have like a whole bin of them. So,
And you don't throw out the ones that you've already been proven to be bad.
No, I definitely throw out those ones. I cut them up and throw them away.
Yeah. Yeah. With a vengeance, with anger, bitterness.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
I save my bad ones and slip them into Eric's tool bag every chance I get.
Yeah. That's what happens. That's how I end up with so many bad
ones. Right. Oh, so many bad ones. Joe, somebody asked a while back, how's the baby? So we need to baby's get a good. Quick update. Baby's good. All right.
Baby's great. Yeah. Good. He's already learning HVAC and can change a capacitor
good.
At 8 months
good.
Old.
It's a good place he to start.
Tries to eat line. It.
Yeah.
Which is, I have to tell him we don't eat our tools.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's coming around.
Good. Good. Is he still enormous?
Yeah. He's giant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Good. All right. Hey, thank you, Eric. Thank you, Joe, Jessica, Chad, Jandy. Anything else you want to add before we bid adieu?
Not until the rack's back up already.
What? I didn't hear anything. You said blah, 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 blah.
I just had to get this rack up and running.
Oh, you've got to get this rack up and running. Okay. Well, you go.
No. I just got it up.
Oh, you just got it up and running. Okay, good, good.
Temporary.
Good. Great. Jandy, Jessica, anything?
It was good. Thank you, guys.
All right. Well, thanks for being here. Jandy, I saw you unmute yourself.
Yeah, I'm good. Thank you.
All right. Awesome. All right. Well, thank you, guys. Appreciate you. And somebody asked when we're going to do these. They're always going to be, for now, on Tuesdays and Thursdays. I'm not going to be here Thursday. I'm actually working at I'm touring a factory, but working on developing a new training program for their line workers, better understand the end user and that sort of thing. So we've talked a lot about this. I'm excited about a lot of these factories and manufacturers wanting to learn more about, what we do and how to build better products. And so that's what I'm going to be doing. Going to be traveling up to Southern Tennessee and Northern Alabama with the whole fam. So
yeah, I turned that down. I was like,
yeah, they went to you first, as they usually do. And then Joe's too busy and then they have to settle and call me. So anyway,
while you're there, tell them to tighten the electrical connections. Don't just put the wires near the components.
Right. Okay. Actually tighten them. Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Work on that.
Please.
It's important that the electrons need wire to move through. So
use the right connectors.
Yeah. All right. Awesome. Thank you all.